Hi, this is Pastor Ken from Vineyard of Hope in Osawatomie, Kansas. My prayer for you today is that God would touch your heart in a real and tangible way for a breakthrough in your life as you hear this message. Thank you for watching, and I want to give you a personal invitation to come and see what we're all about. The church information is at the end of this video. Now I hope you enjoy this message. God bless.
On verse 9, the Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink?" For the Jews did not associate with the Samaritans. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." He would have given you living water. This encounter records so much about the character of Christ, of Jesus. For one of the very few times in her life, she found someone with kindness in his eyes. Think about that. If she had had five husbands prior, and the one that she was living with was not her husband, she had had a lot of stress and just a lot of things that wasn't right in her life. And here, when you think about the love that Jesus Christ has for her and us as well, that there was kindness in his eyes, because we feel the love in us as we read the word and hear the word as well. Instead of critical superiority, she found someone with kindness. This opened her up to continuing to seek understanding of what Jesus was sharing with her. How many of you, when someone is of kind character, that you will listen to what they have to say? Where if they're brash in their talk and they're very forward, and that you tend to shut down, you might be in their company for a while, you might hear words that are spoken, but you're not looking for understanding. But because of the love that Christ has for us, and the reason that he came to earth, that she wanted to have understanding. So in her response, she uses the word "how." In verse 9, she says, "How can you ask me for a drink?" How in this sentence is an interrogative adverb used to ask or elicit information from Jesus. She is asking Jesus, "How is it possible that you as a Jew would ask me for a drink of water?" Here, she is pointing out the obvious. First of all, she is a Samaritan, and a Samaritan was of lesser value than a Jew was. In the eyes of the Jew, a Samaritan was of lesser value. And then second, she was a woman, and a woman was considered to be property in those days, and they also had lesser value than a man. And then we see the culture significance as well, is that the strict rabbis forbade a Jew to greet a woman in public, to even greet a woman in public. I didn't realize that the rabbinical law was so strict that he couldn't even address his wife or his mother or his sisters in public, that he could not greet a woman in public. Because for a rabbi to be speaking to a woman in public was the end of his reputation. That's how strict the rabbinical law was back then. To Jew, the story about the Samaritan is a very amazing story. Jesus doesn't respond to her question in the manner that she expected. He goes directly to the spiritual aspect that he wanted to reveal to her. That's what he does in our lives as well. He goes right to the root of the cause. And a lot of times it's our spiritual, or most of the time, it is our spiritual health that God addresses in our life as well. He appealed to her curiosity by the phrase, "If you knew, if you knew." He implied that because of the nature of his person, he could bestow to her a gift of God that was greater than any ordinary water. This was intended to lift her level of thinking from that of the material need to a spiritual reality. How many of us at times think about our spirit or our physical needs, and we really don't get into the Word and understand the actual spiritual realities that we need to address with God? And then in verse 10, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, Jesus was saying to her, if you had understanding of the nature and the character of who I am. And the gift of God referred to here is John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him would not perish, but they would have eternal life. So we see this was the beginning, just the beginning, of the full extent of the gospel to everyone. Here is God, so loving the world, not in theory, but in action. Not in theory, but in action. And in ordinary language, to the Jew, living water was running water. This was something I learned as well when I was doing this study. I didn't realize that living water to the Jews meant running water. In ordinary thinking, this was in contrast to the well water at Jacob's well. The living water, the running water from the stream, was always better. And if you think about it, we talked about how the well was hand dug, and so whatever is in the ground is what seeps in. It wouldn't be that fresh water that would come off the mountain, the running water. And the Jews had another way of using the word water. They often spoke of the thirst, the soul, for God. They often spoke of quenching that thirst with living water. Jesus was using words that anyone with spiritual insight would have or should have understood. And remember, the Samaritans had ought. They actually had a hatred for the Jews, and so the Jews with the Samaritans, because they wanted to worship on Mount Gerizim when God had established Jerusalem for the place of worship. And then in verse 11, Sir, the woman said, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? So again, she's asking questions. She has wants understanding. She's not turned a deaf ear. She's still seeking understanding from Jesus. But the woman heard his words but missed his meaning. Because of the location of the conversation, she was thinking about the water in the well. She didn't understand how he was going to get water from the well. And the living water meant to her fresh stream water, and not the well, the water the well supplied. Jesus was offering her pure stream water, and she could not understand how he would provide that to her. Her comment was appropriate to one whose comprehension was tied to the earthly and the material. Have you ever had a conversation with someone when you heard their words but you didn't have a good understanding of it? And that's what we see that's here going on, that with where you're at and what you're talking about, you have a total different perspective than what is going on. And so, again, we see that she continues to ask questions. She still wants more information. And then verse 12, are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his flocks and herds? So this woman knows the history, that Jacob and his sons and grandsons are the ones that dug this well. And so she's wondering, are you greater than our father Jacob? The woman's reference to our father Jacob was perhaps designed to bolster the importance of the Samaritan in the eyes of a Jewish rabbi. She wanted to show that she had some knowledge as well, that her heritage went back to Abraham as well. She was well aware of the low self-esteem the Jews had of her people, And Josephus tells us, and Josephus is a historian, Josephus tells us that the Samaritans claim their ancestry through Joseph and Ephraim and Manasseh in the book of Antiquities. So we see that she knows her ancestry, but she's not getting the complete picture of what Jesus is trying to tell her. Verse 13, 14, and 15 I've grouped together. Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again." How many of you on a hot day, especially because we've seen that this is a hot day, you drink that water and you're really thirsty and you drink some more water and you drink some more water and you just don't get your thirst quenched. And that's what we're seeing here, that Jesus says that anyone who drinks from this water will be thirsty again. They will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water that I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." So you see, she still doesn't have the right understanding. She still does not have the right understanding. But look at her enthusiasm. She's really enthusiastic about, "Tell me where I can get this water." Jesus' second reply emphasized the contrast between the water in the well and what he intended to give. The material water would relieve thirst only temporarily, but the spiritual water will quench the thirst forever, forever. And we see in Isaiah 35, 6 through 7, the prophetic word for the messianic time, that the parched ground is to become a pool, and the thirsty ground springs of water. Water will gush forth in the wilderness and the streams in the desert. The burning sand will become a pool, the thirsty ground bubbling springs. I don't know if any of you have been to the desert, but I haven't. But they say at night, if you dig into the sand and you put something in there, that water will actually come into that cup overnight. That's what I've heard. So it's just interesting that Isaiah is giving a prophetic word about what will happen in the future. And we are seeing that, because that is Christ, and Christ himself is the one that can make this prophecy come about. The water in the well had to be drawn up with hard labor. Think about it, it's at least 100 foot deep, and they probably had a rope that they lowered down and then they pulled back up. I don't know if they had a crank or anything like some of the wells I've seen that were the older type wells. But it's still 100 foot deep. To go down that far and then bring it back up with water would be some labor in for, you would have to have labor in that. The spiritual water would bubble up from within. Just like when Tyler was leading in worship, there's a certain amount of our spirit that just rises up if you enjoy worship and you really set your heart and mind to it, that spiritual being of who you are just rises up within you. And this is what Christ is talking to her about, this water. It would bubble up from within. Because of her non-spiritual perspective, the woman's interests were very selfish. All she wanted was something to save the effort of the long, hot trip from the village and then back home again. Then verse 16 and 17 says, "He told her, 'Go call your husband and come back.' 'I have no husband,' she replied. And Jesus said to her, 'You are right when you say you have no husband.'" You are right. Here Jesus is encountering her for the first time. Think about it. Put yourself in her place. And somebody told you something of your past. You are right. You are right. That would definitely get your attention. It would start making you think that this isn't just an ordinary person I'm having a conversation with. And we see later that she says, "I know that you must be a prophet because of what you are saying." And then in the next six verses, The Samaritan woman has to face the truth of her life. Sometimes we don't want to do that, do we? When we're encountered and somebody confronts us, wants to be less accountable, we don't always want to give them the answers they're asking for. We want to sidestep that sometimes. We don't want the truth to be known at times. She was suddenly compelled to face herself and the immorality and the total inadequacy of her life. I think the one time that most of us has probably faced this is when we come face to face with our need for Christ. That in His shadow, we are a wretched sinner. And He is a magnificent, holy God. And yet, He wants that relationship with us. He wants that relationship with us. And so we have to come to face with the truth of what our life is and where it has been. And that's what we see here with the Samaritan woman. There are two revelations in Christianity. The revelation of God, of who He is, the great and mighty God, the creator of the world. But yet, He's that same God that loved us so much that He sent His Son to die on the cross to save us from our sins, so that we then could reestablish that connection that they had at the very beginning in the garden. And the other revelation is of ourselves. No one ever really sees themselves until they see themselves in the presence of Christ. Has anybody else had that experience? I know I have. And it is then that we are revolted at the sight of who we are. Christianity begins with a sense of sin. Begins with a sense of sin. It begins with a sudden realization. It's an awakening to ourselves and of our need for God. Jesus' request to call her husband was both proper and strategic. It was proper and strategic. And as we go through this, you'll see why it was proper. Proper because it was not regarded as good etiquette for a woman to talk with a man unless her husband was present, and strategic because it placed her in a dilemma from which she could not free herself without admitting her need. She had no husband she could call, and she would not want to confess her sexual irregularities to a stranger. The abruptness of her reply shows that she was emotionally touched. How many of you want to tell a complete stranger everything that's happened in your life? I don't think there's any one of us in here that would want to do that. That we hold those things to either our spouse or our closest friend that we have. We don't tell everybody everything in our life. And when you see her background, that she had had five husbands and the one that she was living with was not her husband. Back then, that was a great taboo. Even when I was growing up, you didn't do that. It's very common nowadays, but when I was born and raised, you just didn't do that. The fact is, you have had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have said is quite true. Jesus shocked the woman when He lifted the curtain on her past life. The conversation had passed from the small talk stage to the personal. Her sinful deeds were being exposed by the light, but was she willing to acknowledge the truth? That's the same way with us. Are we willing, when God shows us a part of our life that we need to work on, that we don't have in the right perspective when it comes with our relationship with Christ, are we willing to let Him shine the light of the Holy Spirit into our life, so that we then too can do business with God and align our life up then with Christ? Verses 19 and 20. Sir, the woman said, I see that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem. Realizing his supernatural knowledge, the woman has called him a prophet. But now she tries to divert him. She doesn't want to talk about the things that he wants to talk about. It's too personal, isn't it? Since his probing was becoming uncomfortably personal, she began to argue a religious issue. When I was thinking about that, I thought that even comes with blame shifting. That old commercial said, I don't know, I didn't do it. Mikey must have did it. Or I guess Mikey's the one that ate everything, wasn't he? But there was always this imaginary friend that did something. They didn't do it, but it so-and-so did it. And then if you had brothers and sisters, you could kind of blame shift that direction, but you're in trouble if you had to rely on your imaginary friend if he was the only child. And then as she tries to argue a religious issue, she raised the old controversy between the Jews and the Samaritans whether worship should be offered at Mount Gerizim, at the foot of which they stood, or at Jerusalem, where Solomon's temple had been built. And if you have your maps, let me go through here and see if I find my map. If you have your map, you can see that at the sidecar there, just to the bottom and to the left is Mount Gerizim that they're talking about here. So they're not far from it. Mount Ebal is to the north and the west just a little bit, or basically, I guess, pretty north. But Mount Gerizim is to the south and then to the west just a little bit. So they were pretty close to the mountain there, and so she was bringing something up relevant to where they were actually at the time of this conversation. And the Samaritans founded their claim on the historical fact that when Moses instructed the people concerning the entrance into the promised land, he commanded they set up an altar at Mount Ebal, and the tribes should be divided half on Ebal and half on Gerizim. As the Levites read the law, the people responded alternately. Those on Mount Gerizim pronounced the blessings of God, and those on Mount Ebal the curses of God on sin. I give you the scripture reference there so that you could go back in and read it this week so you can see what was going on before they went into the promised land. The Jews held that since Solomon had been commissioned to build the temple in Jerusalem, the center of worship would be located there. The controversy was endless, and Jesus did not intend to allow himself to be drawn into a futile discussion. Have you ever had a conversation with somebody and at the end you wonder, how did we ever get there? Because it started here and you were going this direction in the conversation and you ended up on a totally unrelated topic that had nothing to do with what you were wanting to have a conversation about. I know I've been in those places as well. And Jesus, you can see him guiding the conversation here. You can see his master craftsman of making sure that he is staying on task of what he's trying to accomplish. And I really believe that he had to leave Jerusalem and go through. He had to. There was a necessity to go through Samaria with this woman in mind. He knew nothing is consequential or circumstantial, I mean. Nothing is circumstantial with Christ. Everything that he does had a plan and a purpose. He knew right when they would get there. He knew that it would be the hot part of the day. This woman would be at the well, and he would have this opportunity. But she, just like us, has to decide what she's going to do with that opportunity. Are we going to engage with Christ and do business with him, or are we going to sidetrack things and turn away from what Christ has for us? We will see what the Samaritan woman does here shortly. Verses 21, 22, and 23. Jesus declared, "Believe me, woman, A time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor on Jerusalem or in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know, and we worship what we do know. The salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, and they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. And we know the rest of the story. No longer is there a temple in Jerusalem, and no longer is there a temple in Mount Gerizim. And this happened after Christ's death on the cross and his ascension. But it happened years after that. And so Jesus is sharing with her that there's no controversy of where to worship, but who you worship, who you worship. Jesus shares that the true worship does not have a location. It does not have a location. Jesus avoided the argument by elevating the issue above the mere location. He made no concessions and stated that the Samaritans' worship was confused. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. He was alluding to the error of the woman's ancestors, who had accepted a combination of different beliefs of foreign deities and the ancestral God of the Jewish faith. True worship is that of the Spirit, which means that the worshiper must deal honestly and openly with God. Honestly and openly with God. She, on the contrary, had been secretive and unwilling to open her heart to God. And we see there's faults in false worship. False worship is a selective worship. A selective worship. False worship, again, is a selective worship. It chooses what it wishes to know about God and omits the rest. A person accepts and holds part of God's truth that suits him and discards the remainder. And this is what Christ is telling her, that you've accepted a combination of different beliefs. So they worshiped and decided what they would keep and use as their instructions for worship. Another false worship is an ignorant worship. Worship should be the approach to God of the complete person or man. We worship God in the same way we love him, with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, and with all our strength. Again, we worship God in the same way that we love him. And then another aspect of false worship is superstitious worship. Superstitious worship. It is a worship given not out of a sense of need or real desire. It is a worship given out of fear that if they don't worship God, it will invoke the wrath of God. It will invoke the wrath of God. We've seen that as I was talking about Gideon. The townspeople, they were upset because Gideon had destroyed the altars of Baal and Asherah, and they wanted him to die. And then his father intervened, and when they come for Gideon, and he said, if Baal is a god, let him save himself. Let him save himself. Because they had a fear that if they didn't worship God, there would be evil consequences. And then verse 24, God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in spirit and in truth. The Greek word used here for worship is a present active verb, and this verb denotes action from those giving worship. So it shows at this present time, and it shows action. The sense of the word is to prostrate yourself in the presence of the divine or supernatural as a sign of respect, admiration, and worship. We don't live in a society where there's kings and queens, but when you came into the throne room of a king or a queen, you had to bow before them. You wouldn't just go in and walk in like it's just anything, but you had to show respect in that way. And again, God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in spirit and truth. carries one of the four descriptions of God found in the New Testament. Again, God is Spirit is one of those truths. The other three are God is light, and you'll find that reference in John 1:15, God is love. You'll find that in 1 John 4:8-16, and God is a consuming fire. And you'll see that in Hebrews 12:29. Jesus was endeavoring to convey to the woman that God cannot be confined to one place nor conceived as a material being. Because that's what the idols and the gods were. They were material. And that's where some people struggle with coming to Christ, is because it is someone that's not tangible. They have to take Christ and God and the Holy Spirit on faith. They have to take them on faith. He cannot be represented adequately by an abstract concept, which is basically impersonal, nor can any idol depict his likeness, since he is not material. Only the Word became flesh could represent him adequately. And here, she was in the presence of the Word in flesh, the incarnate Christ. Jesus pointed to the true worship that God is Spirit. If God is Spirit, then he is not confined to things. He's not confined to material things. The conflict of where to worship is no longer relevant. God's nature surpasses any and all limits man would conceive. True worship is when man, through his Spirit, attains to friendship and intimacy with God. I really enjoy that. One of those songs that came out a few years ago about I'm a friend of God. That, you know, we are friends with God, but yet he is a holy God, even though he wants a relationship with us. We worship God in truth because God is truth. In fact, he is the absolute truth. He is the absolute truth. If you claim that you have a relationship with God through salvation, and you do not live your life according to the truth, then you are living your life a life of deception. Your life shows the true condition of your heart. You are fundamentally in opposition to God, and you are outside the kingdom of heaven if you do not live your life according to the truth. And that's not in reference to those that try to live according to the truth, because we are not perfect. We do make mistakes, but we still use the Word of God to be our standard that we go by. We read the Word, we search the Scriptures to find out what it means to live a godly life, to live a godly life. In verse 25, the woman said, I know that the Messiah called Christ is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us. So they too had in their religious background the belief of the Messiah, that the Messiah would come and rescue them. The woman was bewildered by Jesus' words, and there were many things that were beyond her understanding, but what she had heard from Jesus was full of wonder. Have you ever been in a conversation with somebody that you just are just taken away by what they have to say, and it's a good thing? I'm not talking about being sidetracked something that isn't of God, but you just wonder where they got all their depth and learning and their understanding, and you just want to be in their presence. We see here, but what she had just heard from Jesus was full of wonder. The woman finally confessed her ignorance, and at the same time expressed her longing. I know that the Messiah is coming. I know that the Messiah is coming. So when he comes, he will explain everything to us. It was the one vague hope that she had of finding God, for she expected that the coming Messiah would explain the mysteries of life. Would explain the mysteries of life. There was a Samaritan tradition that the prophet predicted by Moses in Deuteronomy 18:15 would come to teach God's people all things. On the sincere though vague hope, Jesus founded his appeal to her spiritual consciousness. In the sense of the phrase, he will explain, to bring back the message, Christ the Messiah came to inform us of all things. And that's what we see him doing in the Gospels of the Word of God. Then Jesus declared, I who speak to you am he. Well, what a revelation. I am he that am standing here right with you. I am he. And remember, the disciples aren't there. It's just a conversation, an encounter, a personal encounter that she's having with Christ. He now voluntarily represents himself to this sinful woman openly as the Messiah. The Synoptic Gospels show that normally he would not make such a public claim. On the contrary, he urged his disciples to say nothing about it. And we see that in the references of Matthew 16:20, Mark 8:29 and 30, and Luke 9:20 and 21. In Galilee, where there are many would-be messiahs and a constant unrest based on the messianic hope, such a claim could be very dangerous. And we've seen that back when John the Baptist, when the Pharisees and the Levites were questioning John the Baptist, he said, I'm not the Messiah. I'm not the Messiah. Because there was political overtones associated. Because the Jews believed that when the Messiah come, that he would then establish his kingdom here on earth. They had their understanding wrong in that aspect. And so we see that was one of the reasons that he told his disciples not to say anything publicly. And in Galilee, there were many would-be messiahs and a constant unrest based on the messianic hope. Such a claim would have been dangerous. The Jews looked upon the Messiah as a king of Israel and expected from him, first of all, political changes. But we see in John 6:15, Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again to a mountain by himself. And so we see that when they tried to make him the Messiah, he was able to get away and withdrew himself. In Samaria, the concept would probably have been regarded more as religious than political and would have elicited a ready hearing for his teachings rather than a rebellious revolt. In Jerusalem, it would have had a different impact. And while the Samaritans, deriving their messianic expectations chiefly from Deuteronomy 18:15 through 19, they regarded him simply as a prophet or a teacher and were less liable to abuse this revelation for disturbing political reasons. Lord God, I just thank you for your word, Lord, and I thank you that just as the Samaritan woman was having an encounter to Christ, that we too can have that encounter with you, Lord. That initial encounter when we come to know you for the very first time as our Lord and Savior, and then on a daily basis that we can come to you and have that personal, relevant encounter with you each and every day. And it's not just a once a day, but it's a constant experience every day if we so choose to have that, God. And I just thank you for who you are in each and every one of the people here today and in my life as well, Lord, that as we leave here tonight, Lord, that you would continue to watch over each and every one of us and that you would bless us. And we look forward to coming back to assemble as a body of believers again on Sunday morning. In Jesus' name, amen.